I'm Brad Keelor, Director of the Geo-Institute. Welcome to another great episode of Director's Cut. Before we get to the interview, I need to tell you about a contest we're running for the 100th episode of Director's Cut. That's right, we're almost to 100 shows. Our special episode will air November 9th and will feature geo-legend Jim Mitchell as my guest, and you can be involved too. Submit your question for Jim at the link in the show notes below, and if it's chosen, you'll get a $200 discount on registration for Geo-Congress 2023. It's a great way to be involved in Director's Cut and to save a little money on your trip to Los Angeles in March. Thanks for watching, thanks for your questions, and now let's get to this week's episode.
I am Brad Keelor. She is Sissy Nikolaou. Find out next on Director's Cut. The purchase she made that made her dog look like a shark. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every single week, I sit down with a different GI member who has stories to tell. Some of them are personal, some are professional, all of them are fun. If you don't know anything about the Geo-Institute, after you watch this today, you should head over to geoinstitute.org. While you are there, you will find out of very many things. One of them is that we are a technical society with about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and or geologists, and we are part of the American Society of Civil Engineers. If you like what you see today, and I think you will, you should do a few things. You should click like, subscribe, get notifications, and if you do those things, we will let you know every time we post something to our YouTube channel. It is a special time of year at the Geo-Institute. I mean, every time of year is special. But October is really special because we welcome new members to the Board of Governors, and we have a new president of the Geo-Institute every single year because it's only a one-year term. This week, we are joined by our brand new Geo-Institute president from New York City. But she works down here in the D.C. area at the National Institute of Standards and Technology, where she is the earthquake engineering group leader and, again, the new Geo-Institute president. It is Sissy Nikolaou. Sissy, welcome.
Hi, Brad. Thank you.
We are going to have a great time today, as we always do on Director's Cut. We have 10 questions. We ask two of the same ones to every single guest. We start with one of those. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
So my formal job is to lead the earthquake engineering group at NIST, which is a group of researchers. We have in-house research projects, but also outside research projects. And also we support our statutory programs, particularly NIHRP, the National Earthquake Hazards Reduction Program. These days, for about a year now, I have kind of shifted my focus because I co-lead the geotechnical part of the National Construction Safety Team investigation to the partial collapse of the Surfside condominium in Florida. So that takes most of my time.
We will talk a little bit more about NIST and a little bit more about the different things that you do later on in the interview and about being GI president. But we must ask some fun questions before we get to some of that. And we lead off with this. What is the silliest purchase you have ever made?
So I have made many silly purchases and I'm a serial purchaser. At fault, but there is a very recent one that relates to Halloween. I got a costume that I thought would be super cute for my mini Aussie, Lily, and it's a ladybug. And she does not look like a ladybug at all. It's like everybody saw. I tried it on her, it fit. I, you know, and it's like no, this dog doesn't look like a ladybug. She was uncomfortable in it, and she kind of looked silly. And we realized she's more like a shark, and we are going in that direction. But I made sure to take a picture of my failure.
Sharks are fiercer than ladybugs, so maybe that's okay. Is this the first attempt you guys have made at a dog costume?
Oh, no. We dress her without any reason, but usually it's bandanas. You know, she's a baby still, so it's her first Halloween. And we put glasses on her and all that, but not a full costume. So it was a big failure on my end because everybody's like, what were you thinking?
So the bandanas and stuff, I totally get the bandanas. I've seen that. You put glasses on the dog. How did they stay on there?
Well, no, they don't stay for a long time. I mean, we do some construction to make them stay on. Or other stuff we put, like I want to put jewelry. She's not that type of dog, you know?
Wait, hold it. Is any dog that type of dog?
No. We had our previous dog was much more into, because she was a show dog, and I guess it runs in her blood. It wasn't affecting her. This dog is a wild thing. We cannot keep her straight. She takes off the leash. It's a lot going on. So definitely she wasn't a ladybug. It's like a wishful thinking on my end.
I like that, though. I want to see photos of the dog with glasses, because that is amazing.
I'll send them to you.
We do broach some serious topics on Director's Cut, despite all the laughter and hilarity. 10 years ago this very month, Hurricane and then Superstorm Sandy battered the East Coast of the U.S. and Canada. It's sort of a milestone anniversary to be 10 years past that. Obviously, you were in New York at the time, and so it impacted you. 10 years on, what do you think, what would you like to see in the way we change our approach societally to extreme events?
Yeah, it's something very important, because I think the way that we deal with extreme events is, in a way, we chase the hazard. So hazards are something we cannot control, right? So to just look at it as a demand in our system and say, oh, now the flood level should be higher because Sandy happened. Does this mean we are doing a good job? Like, nature always finds a way to make things worse, especially in an environment where climate change is exposing us by default to worse conditions. So seeing, you know, the hurricanes that came after, and you know, we need to change a little bit our thinking about hazards and look at how we could protect, and based on the risk we are accepted, we are willing to accept as society, as engineers, versus them. Okay, let's raise the bar. Let's put a bigger earthquake or a bigger hurricane. That's no longer enough, because what we're dealing with is exposure, bigger exposure to risk, just because of fatigue, use, climate, under normal conditions. So we need to look at things a little bit more systematically and a little bit more, I would say, aggressively. Stop repeating what we have been doing all these years and look at it from something we can control, which is risk. We cannot control nature for the most part.
So how do you think we get to that point? Because one of the things I always think about is recorded weather history, at least in the United States, is about 150 years old now. There were obviously hurricanes, floods, earthquakes, other natural disasters before that time. Do you feel like we really have a good picture of the risk level that we should be accepting of? Or do you feel like we look at it from a lens of people living in 2022 with all the stuff that we have, and that we've decided on the risk level that's acceptable because of the stuff that we've built over the years? I don't know if that question makes sense.
Oh, yes, it does make sense, because I think it's very much a communication issue. Like, Does the average person know what it means? I'm designing for one in 2,500 year earthquake. Like most people think it's something that happens every 2,500 right. years. So if one happens now, oh, we are good for thousands of years. It's like, no, it's not like that. So it is something that is not going to happen with certainty of 98% within the lifetime of your building, which would be 50 years, right? And it's a random event. It can happen again tomorrow if it happens mm-hmm. yesterday. So I think that, especially when I did the reconnaissance after Sandy for gear and having done many reconnaissance missions after earthquakes, I see that the perception of people of what we are designing for as engineers is very different than the reality. And I think using numbers that not non-experts do not understand makes it, it gives a false sense of safety on this thing. So I was looking at data for Washington, D.C., specifically about precipitation and rainfall and weather effects and climate. And I realized that the predictions are, I think, by year 2080, that the one in 100-year flood or extreme rain event is going to be now one in 15 years. So what are we going to do? It's either we're going to accept that we can design something for something that severe every 15 years. We're going to keep raising the water design elevations. Or do we want to say that, you know, we as a city, as a community, as a block, as a system, we want to remain functional or we want to be back in function within certain hours, days, certain percentage of traffic, whatever it is, risk is not just the structural damage risk. It's a lot of other things that cost more money, but also people understand much easier. Like if you tell somebody your kid's school is going to be shut down for 6 months, it makes a very big difference yep. for your life, as we saw with COVID, right? It's something I think it's quite fresh in people's memories. Like, how long does it take to go back to normal or whatever we consider to be normal? So it's a bigger conversation, I think. The risk conversation should not be only technocratic or only stakeholders and politicians' discussion. It should be a collective opinion after everybody understands what we are talking about. Like, I've been in a huge earthquake, huge in terms of the recordings that were made in Greece in 2014. And remarkably, a building did not collapse, which was worst case scenario for it, like a corner building with masonry infills and all that stuff that typically collapse. And the record said it should have collapsed big time. Actually, it should be flying. It had like accelerations more than 1G. So nothing had happened to it. So we wanted to understand why, which is a fantastic idea, by the way, for reconnaissance, is to understand why things did not fail. So we went in and talked to the people. They were so upset, Brad. I swear to God, I don't understand. We were like, this is amazing. We have to study this. And they were like, you don't understand. Our TV was shaken and this vase fell down and this thing broke. And I was like, you are alive.
Yeah.
So, you know, even the concept of life safety is it only looks at what happens right after an event.
Yep.
It doesn't look at your, you know, your life quality after the event. So it's a big conversation. And I think it's an opportunity also for Geo-Institute and geotechnical engineers to make, you know, our work more understandable, because all of this stuff, the hurricanes, the floods, all of these extreme events involve infrastructure, and particularly infrastructure that involves a lot of geotechnical work. So
that is great. And we're going to come back to this a little bit later on in the show. For now, I have to ask a question about New York City. I'm never super secretive about this. I'm not a huge fan of New York City. I know many people are not. I do like going there sometimes. For you, if you had to do a tourism campaign, what is the most compelling reason you can think of why somebody should move to New York City? And not just visit, why they should move there?
To move, yeah. Well, it's definitely you love it or you hate it type of situation, as people say. I think I fell in love at first sight with New York. My pitch would be, you know, obviously the variety of cultures that you get to interact with, the amazing food, the amazing entertainment. And it's really a beautiful place to be that has, it's like a concentration of all these different languages and backgrounds. And it's always, there is a feeling of an alive city, maybe because you walk everywhere and you talk to people, but especially this time of the year, you know, with the leaves changing, I don't know how somebody cannot be in love with New York, where you have all the, obviously the park changing the colors and all that. And at the same time, you have the most amazing skyline in the world in the background. So it is an amazing place to be. It's not for everybody, I think, because there is a lot of, you know, high speed, you know, situations, like people run all the time to go from one place to another. And professionally, you know, there is exposure to a lot of different opportunities, exposure to amazing projects. Even if the projects are not in New York, you, as an engineer, you probably are going to find companies that work around the world, but their base is in New York. So there is a lot of things that I love about it.
So for our viewers, if you're interested in moving to New York, you can contact Sissy and she'll help you find a place to live. She'll help you relocate after that passionate argument for why people should move to New York. We also mentioned at the top that you're working for NIST now. And for those of you out there in viewer land who don't know anything about NIST, it's a federal agency that was created in 1901 as the National Bureau of Standards, I believe. I'm trying to remember. This is tough. Yes. And now it takes on much more than that. It's a collection of labs that do all kinds of amazing things for the country. You started working for NIST a little over a year ago, right? Or has it been longer than that now?
Yeah, about a year and a half ago.
So for you, what has been the most surprising thing to you about working in a federal job?
Yeah, so the one bad thing is that the bureaucracy is worse than I expected in many cases. And the amount of passwords that you have to maintain and keep changing all the time is like...
But don't even, write any like, of them down or it's a security breach.
No, you cannot. But what are you supposed to do? Like, how much can your brain hold? But really, what really surprised me, maybe I had a different perception of, you know, how things are in the government, is the amount of people. I mean, all the people that I have met have a true sense of serving. And there are so many people I meet. So my division is the structures and materials division. There's all these brilliant people that I meet. And I, as a consultant in my previous professional life, I'm thinking, you know, these people could be making like two times, like a lot more than what they're doing. But it's just that they have a pure love and dedication to what they do. And especially when you respond to a disaster, which was like, I was a few months into this when we responded. And, you know, I met a lot of my colleagues on site because it was COVID time and I in Miami. And this is where I realized, you know, these people work around the clock, you know, 24/7 because they are dedicated to what they do. And I think their heart is in the right place. They're very good at what they do. So that was a little bit surprising to me from what I could see from the outside. It's very different when you see things from inside.
That's great. And if anybody ever gets a chance to go to NIST, I will tell you, you should go. Exit 9 on 270. All kinds of cool stuff. If you're really special, you might get to see the kilogram, but you have to be really, really special to see the kilogram. But you can see the zero energy house. You can see the steel beam from the World Trade Center. I'm trying to think of other cool things that are on the NIST campus. There are a lot of them. Definitely worth a visit if you get a chance. The other question that we ask everybody when they come on the show is kind of an obvious one. How did you get involved in ASCE and GI?
Well, obviously I knew ASCE before even I came to this country. The journals was what I was more familiar with. When I started working in New York, I was mostly involved with the Met section here in New York, which is an amazing section, very big, a lot of activities, a lot of opportunities here and all that. And with a bigger GI, I'll be honest about it. It looks like something that you could not reach, at least in my earlier years. I was involved with the Soil Dynamics Committee, because that's my field. So on a technical level, I was mostly involved. And the opportunity came for the board. And I was a little skeptic. I was like, I'm not sure how I would fit there. And I think a lot of things have changed when I look back. It was definitely worth the time we all put in, especially when you see even small changes happening.
Yeah.
It really makes it all worthwhile, and things have changed for the better. It was very intimidating for me too when I was asked to be on the board. I wasn't sure if I'm going to make it and all that, but I think with the group of the other members who were all very supportive and amazing, it did make a difference to be able to stay and serve for a few years.
Well, yeah, we've been talking about that a lot lately. So now that you're president, this is year 6 on the board for you. I think it's great that you started out with a chapter there and gave a shout out to those guys. The Met section chapter in particular is excellent, from their annual event to the CAP lecture and the Langan lecture and all the other great stuff that they do. This is where, viewers, we make that pitch again. If you want to get involved with your local GI group and you don't know how, we'll put a link down in the notes to this show so that you can find the chapter closest to you, reach out to them and say, yes, I would like to be involved. That was a lot of words all at once without a breath. The next question I had to put in here, because it's one that I think about a lot. I feel like every parent has to think about this at some point. When your family has to make a quick dinner, what are your go-to foods?
Other than takeout.
It can be takeout too, but other than takeout is a good place to start.
Yeah, it could be takeout. Here we can order all kinds of different things, but at some point you get bored. So one of the things we like to make quickly is if we have mozzarella and tomato, we can make some good ciabatta bread. We like to make like little sandwiches and that makes everybody happy in general. Quickly, you know, sometimes just a plain pasta with some tomato sauce. Otherwise, if it has to be fast, it would be takeout, delivery.
What is the number one takeout that everybody always likes and no one ever complains about in your house?
No, there is no such thing. There is no consensus on this.
I have no idea what that's like.
Oh, yeah? We know you have teenagers, Brad.
Actually, that's not true. We've got one. We have a Lebanese place down the street that everybody always likes. We never get complaints for that, even from the parents when we order from there, meaning my parents or my in-laws. That's like the only one, though. Everybody else always has an issue with something else.
Yes. We typically have issues. Like, everybody likes pizza, but it has to be from this place or that place. My kids love sushi. I don't like it. So we end up, usually it's a combination of things. If we want everybody to be happy, or if everybody's hungry, you know, just throw a pizza and that's it.
Always a winner. That for us, the other one is Trader Joe's orange chicken. Nobody ever complains about that. So you still got to make other stuff though. It's good. Now we're going to get back to this. I don't know what we call this topic. It's not really the resilience topic, but we can go to that. I want to talk a little bit more about your work at NIST on this extreme events topic and recovery and resilience. Recently, actually, you're going to have to clarify this a little bit for me. It was congressionally directed. I know that the Functional Recovery Framework guidelines for you guys and for FEMA. Can you talk a little bit more about that, where it came from, how it affects you, and what impact it's going to have on the geotechnical profession?
Yeah, I'd be happy to talk about that. Yes, this is this report was published in 2021. It's available online. It's the NIST FEMA report on recommendations for functional recovery framework. And it was the result of a request by the Congress to NIST and FEMA to create such a document, to convene a set of experts that worked on this to come up with a better than code type of framework or recommendations for a framework that would include a reasonable return to service for the society of the functions of buildings and infrastructure systems. So the concept is that right now we design for extreme events, for earthquakes in particular, for life safety, which means that a new building that you design per code in a very big earthquake, in the maximum considered earthquake, it may sustain significant damage, but it's going to give you the chance to get out of it alive.
Yeah.
Right? So that's the concept of life safety. Now, you know, how long it's going to take you to go back to this building is a combination, obviously, of the structural damage, but also very simple stuff. Like, if you're toilet is not working, you cannot go back, even if structurally the building is fine, or the elevator, or whatever it is that you need to function, right? So the other driver of this, obviously, it's a societal need, right, to evolve the way that we think, which thank you for the first question, because it connects very much to how we think. The other part is that this costs most of the money lost from disasters. So usually the actual physical damage is much less than the damage from downtime. Like, look at Sandy. Like, yeah. There was not significant structural damage other than some cases. But how much does it cost us for the money market to be down, for Wall Street to be shut, or our tunnels, trains, subway system is not working? This is what costs money. So this report is very interesting because it sets the tone of what needs to be done, which is, we see it as a bridge to resilience. So I think resilience is a term that it's hard for all of us to be on board on what it means. But the term functional recovery is something that we all understand, right? How long is it going to take you to go back home, to go back to work, for your highway to be again in service, right? So we call this a bridge from performance-based design to community resilience, which is a much bigger planning issue in addition to the engineering issue. So we look at design in a component level, in a building or a lifeline level, but also in a system level approach, with having goals not only of performance, but also return to service. And, you know, how do you have a consensus of how much this time, what is the appropriate time? Obviously, we want to have different categories of buildings and lifelines, that some are more critical than others. So we started conducting workshops after this report was published, and with stakeholders, with the public, with engineers, consultants, government officials, representatives from community. And it's amazing the consensus you get from these different groups on how long this should be. So we have another report that shows the results of this workshop. And it really is amazing to me what a consensus you get when you put people around the table and you talk about things that they understand, going back to the conversation we had about risk. Mm-hmm. And one important thing is that, you know, the perception of people investing on prevention or investing on new concepts is that, oh, that's going to cost me more, right? It's not always the case, and it's not the case if you do smart investments. And we have, you know, now that this report is published, we try to look at different lifeline systems and how this can work and be combined with regular maintenance, which is the key. If you can think about functional recovery when you're maintaining or creating a new facility or a new lifeline, then you will get the benefit of it. And it's not going to cost more. It's going to give you so many more benefits. But the developers or the decision makers have to understand that in order to, you know, to explain it and to, in a way, sell it, right? So it's a new concept. And I think it's we are in this for a long time.
And a coordinated federal effort. I can't undersell what a big deal that is, because I think especially for a body like Congress to look at something like this and see that more than one agency is involved makes a big difference. There have been a lot of these efforts over the years, these multi-agency things, like think of the Subcommittee on Disaster Reduction, which was convened by the White House, and the years when that was strong, I feel like they did a lot of great coordination work among the agencies rather than letting everybody do their own thing willy-nilly. And when that committee wasn't strong, everybody kind of went off and did their own thing, and money isn't efficiently spent, and plans vary from agency to agency too much. So this is really encouraging, and seems like it'll have some good positive effects that'll trickle down to community level as well. So that is really good. So thank you for that. So we've got two questions left. You are now having to travel a lot between New York and DC. You take some longer trips as well, but this is the one that made me think this. What are your favorite ways to pass the time on a long drive or train or plane ride?
Well, I like to, I have like a playlist of that I like to play, especially in driving. So it is the 80s for me. So I have a very nice playlist that I enjoy. It's like my downtime. It's my downtime when I drive to DC. I enjoy it. In planes, I like to download movies or listen to books, which are outside of the engineering domain usually. So it's, yeah, music. Music, it's my time that nobody can judge me about what I'm listening to.
Especially the people under 18 that live in your house. I know how that goes. Do you read exclusively non-engineering books?
No. I love reading books about physics, about things that are connected to engineering that are also technical in nature. But, you know, it's when I was trying, for example, to understand the resilience concept, and I was reading the Black Swan and all the stuff that in implementing resilience in engineering. And a lot of it came out of my alma mater, you know, in Buffalo. Mm-hmm. I started reading a lot about risk in how you invest in stocks or things that are not expected, but can have very big impact in history. and how this can be triggers or can be the decisive events that have made a difference. And also in psychology about resilience of people. And you get amazing ideas if you are able to project into engineering these concepts. And it has really helped me to think a little bit, you know, out of the box, especially when you talk about things like, at the end of the day, people's happiness, right? Because yeah. We talked about functional recovery and not how miserable are people when they cannot go back to their house or yeah. They cannot function. And other people are more resilient than others. Like, what have the studies shown? So I like to read out, and of course, you know, fiction and all that, but things that could be relating to my work, I like to try to think what would that mean for a design, you know? And a lot of great stuff happen if you let your mind
yes.
travel a little bit.
That is perfect then. We have to end with this. You are, of course, your term as president started at something like 4:20 p.m. on Friday afternoon or something.
On
like
Brad's
that.
Birthday.
It was my birthday. So for the next year, I realize a one-year presidency is not very long, and a lot of people like to point that out. I think the rebuttal to that should be, if you were on the board that whole time, you would think that a year is actually a very long time. What are you most hopeful about in your year as GI president, or for your year as GI president?
It is not a long time but we don't work like that. We don't work like somebody right. becomes president and they flip things and all that. So the work that
you're not going to be an authoritarian. That's...
we have invested, as you know, in many initiatives, in things that we think should be changing. And I think the concept also of the past president to be so involved after, it gives this continuity that is yeah. very, very important. And we have made a lot of changes. I'm very hopeful about keeping and energizing, especially our younger members, on ideas of innovation. We just talked a lot about functional recovery. I think it very much connects to geotechnical innovation on how we can get there with instrumentation, with a lot of things that we have in the newly formed innovations committee and all these cool gadgets that we can use to get us there. But you know, this is a challenge for the younger generation. We are not going to solve this. I hope we can energize our very, very innovative members. So, you know, the geotechnical engineering by default is innovative. So I hope to continue the initiatives we have set with Bob Gilbert and Jim Collins and everybody else to make sure that I bring them one step forward in the right direction and work with others to continue this, but also create and continue to have a non-intimidating leadership and to be very inclusive and make sure that we continue this great tradition of serving for the Geo-Institute at all levels. So that is my priority.
Great answer. It's almost like an acceptance speech, an induction speech. It's fantastic. We're looking forward to another really good year, and I think it will be. So thank you for that, and thank you for serving all these years on the board and with the local chapter and on the Earthquake Engineering Soil Dynamics Committee. We really appreciate it. Of course, our society is made strong by the contributions of members like you. Sissy, you made it through all 10 questions. I knew you would, but it's still an accomplishment, so you should be proud of that. For our viewers, if you liked what you saw, and again, you're here at the end, so you probably did, click like, click subscribe, click get notifications. We will let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. So Sissy, thanks again.
Thank you, Brad, and thank you for everything that you do.
Sometimes it's tough, but we all persevere. We make it through. And for the viewers, we will see you with a brand new Director's Cut next week. We'll be right back.